All right, we are back here, and of course we have D1 and Zero here, special guests, to help us learn Smash Brothers. So we're just gonna try to get into it, and let us know if this kills audio or anything like that, but this this should be fine, so you should be able to still hear us, but we wanted to do full screen here, mostly because the game is really pretty, so... But, okay, so we talked about a lot of these things here, but we haven't gotten into special moves or jump attacks yet, and this is really important as well. So let's go ahead and get into that here, and just do, sure, Final Destination. All right, so every character has four special moves.
Yes.
Right?
They're outfitted with an up B, down B, neutral B, and side B. Right. And now the cool thing is, not only do these characters also have like four special attacks, but sometimes you can enhance them by putting a smash while doing the side B.
Some side Bs have differences whether you smash or tilt the control stick. For example, Diddy Kong's monkey flip, which is his side B. Oh,
right.
Other moves, for example, you can charge them, so you can hold the B button. For example, Samus to charge it.
Mm-hmm.
Some other moves,
yeah, like Samus's side B also has the smash or the regular.
The
version,
missile,
right?
the missile.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And of course, basically whatever special move you have on the ground in the air. They mostly do the same thing in the air, right?
No.
But with variations, right?
For example, Samus can charge her shot on the ground, but not in the air.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
Some moves have changed completely based on the,
okay,
air,
okay,
the ground.
Okay.
Yeah, they might even have like certain moves that in the air, on the ground, when you execute it, it might have invulnerability on startup,
mm-hmm.
but then in the air, it doesn't.
Okay.
For example,
yeah.
Meta Knight's up B in Brawl had invincibility on the first frame on the ground, but it didn't on the air. And they had completely different knockbacks and damage and everything.
Okay,
moves.
Okay.
That's character specific stuff to get into.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then also jump attacks. There's actually five versions of jump attacks, right? Because like we said, you can't turn around when you jump. So if you hit the A button, there's actually a difference between forward air and back air, right?
Yes. Certain characters are given like a spike when they do their forward air, or they're able to either just like approach with it. They're all really different, but for the most part, whenever you execute a forward air, you'll have a hitbox coming out in front of you. Sometimes it's instant, sometimes it's not as quick, and the same goes for like back aerials.
Right,
generally, I'd say back aerials are usually the, with some characters, like a KO tool, right? But then others, it's like a forward air. So it depends. It's really specific.
The thing with the aerials is that all of them have different uses. For example, let's go over Mario's just to give you an idea.
Uh-huh.
For example, Mario's back air serves as either a landing tool because it pushes people back when they shield it. It also works as a spacing tool because it's safe on shield.
Mm-hmm.
Mario's forward is also spike, which is powerful off the stage. Mario's upper works as a combo tool. His downer works as a shield pressure one. And his nair works as a landing cross-up like this.
Oh, nice.
So,
okay.
For example, for another character, all his arrows or her arrows will have completely different uses.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So arrows are just like ground moves in the sense that they can do anything pretty much.
Yeah.
Okay. So you really just have to learn which ones.
Yes.
Okay.
And a lot of characters, obviously, you know, we talked about moves being kill moves. Like, some characters, their best kill move is back air, is bear, and then some of them are forward air, some
mm-hmm.
of them are up air. It just depends on the character,
yep.
right? And then they also all have different landing lags, if
yes.
I'm not mistaken, right?
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And you just have to know what the landing lag is on your move. Because, like, I use Zelda, and her forward air and back air just have ridiculous landing lag. I mean, she... If you miss those attacks, you're just dead.
Yeah,
much.
So another thing, when people get into this game, they definitely need to learn, like, which moves, you know, have significant landing lag and which doesn't, so that they know what their approach options are.
Right,
you know?
Okay. I didn't know Mario had a wall jump.
It's just like in this game.
That makes sense, yeah.
Yeah,
like,
I know.
Yeah. Yeah.
So characters that you will not expect have double jumps, like characters that didn't have a double jump in their own games, have one in this game, which is weird. Like Little Mac having a wall jump, for example.
Yeah, and Dr. Mario, who didn't have a wall jump
in
Melee, but in this game, out of nowhere,
he
hit the gym.
Okay.
And he could do parkour.
Nice, okay.
is there, it seems like there's not, but is there any limit to air actions that you can take?
No.
Other than jumps, but number of attacks?
No, there's okay. none. You can just do as many as you can.
Yeah.
For example, Mario can do two back airs on one short hop.
Yeah, I see.
Oh, dang.
But he can only do one forward from a short hop. Okay. He can also do two uppers.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So it just depends on how slow your moves are or whatever like that, right? How laggy your moves are. Now, is it really dangerous to jump attack a lot of people? Like, is there a lot of,
like anti-airs on the ground?
Yeah, I mean, anti-airs, and I notice when I play, like, every time I jump attack people, they just block and throw me and stuff like that, right? So let's get into shielding really quick then, I guess, you know, how shield works. There's basically another button, which is the shield button, which is the shoulders, if you assign it that way. And this is how you block in the game, essentially, right? So, like I said, like, one thing I'm starting to learn about this from a traditional fighting game, there's something called block stun. When you block something, you're kind of stuck in block for a while, right? It's a lot less in this game compared to other fighting games, right?
Well, the thing is that few info drops. Shielding in Smash is one frame universal. So shielding is by far the safest option to do in almost every scenario. And it's also the fastest action you can do possibly in the game. In every Smash game, they have different amounts of shieldstone, which is what we call it. In 64, if you shield, it's kind of like in Street Fighter where you are locked in that period of time for a long period of time, which makes in that game shield in death because some characters can hit your shield and then they break it because you can no longer unshield. So then you get comboed to death. In Melee, shielding was made a little bit better than in 64, making it so people can do more actions out of it. But moves also had a lot of shield pushback. So people were able to... Okay, you're shielding, let me do this safe move in your shield. You can't do anything to punish me. Might as well just stop blocking.
Right.
In Brawl, they reduced the amount of shield pushback that moves had. So a lot of moves that you thought you could punish, in reality, were really, really, you know, unsafe in a shield and you can punish them. And also, the amount of shield drop release, because in this game, when you shield and then you drop your shield, you have lag, a certain amount of lag. In Brawl, it's 7 frames. In this game, it's I believe it's either 7 or 6. And that makes it so, for example, I can do math to punish you, for example. If I know your jab has like 10 frames of cooldown, and I know Mario's jab is 2, so if I do 7 to drop my shield to the jab, it's 9. So I have 1 frame of error, I can punish you.
Yeah. Interesting. So wait, exactly. So if you let go of your shield while the shield is dropping, I mean, while you're letting go and you said that 7 frames, you're still shielding in those 7 frames?
No, you're not. Actually some wind up you can get punished on.
Okay,
which is
okay.
What makes jumping from your shield good, because you don't suffer that 7 frame lag.
Yeah.
Okay,
but the big difference in this game that you mentioned is that when you jump at someone and they block and you can't really do anything because you get shield grab, it's because in this game, they reduce the shield pushback more than any other Smash game.
Okay.
So for example, in Melee, if I do a back air on your shield, that will push it twice as far. You can shield grab it, but in this game, you can shield grab it.
Gotcha.
And
gotcha.
There's also another really complicated mechanic that in this game, you can, if you get hit when you're shielding, you can literally smash your control stick forth, and your character will move forth with the shield, and you can grab certain things that you couldn't. Yes, I know.
Wait, say it again.
It's complicated. So, for example, if I shield,
and
then you move forth while you're getting pushed back by the shield, the game will move you forth a tiny bit so you can punish certain things that you couldn't.
Yeah, they call that shield AI. So, basically, while you're in the block stun, as minimal as it is, you're still able to influence your, you know,
you
where
you...
You
still move forward a little bit afterwards?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because a lot of times when I block stuff, I've just tried grabbing right away, and I'll miss them because they're a little further.
Mm-hmm.
I should actually hit forward and then try to grab after blocking.
Interesting.
Yes.
Okay.
Jeez. Okay.
In fact, in Brawl, the shield SDI was so big that you were able to, like, literally transport your character, like a wave dash distance, like a dash distance.
Dang.
It was a lot.
Okay.
In this game, it's much less, but it makes the distance enough to... make or fail, you know, a shield grab. So
right. Okay.
So you can move the shield around a little bit as you're shielding, right?
Yeah, this works for...
Is that useful?
Yeah, for shield sound. For example, if I shield here, you can see my head is vulnerable. What if I do this? Like, for example, I shield and then, you know?
Oh, you can actually hit where it's not graphically shielded.
Yes.
Then
you get hit.
Okay.
Okay, so as you hold shield, it shrinks. So the more you abuse this, the more it shrinks. And then as you block attacks, it gets smaller too, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then, so as it gets smaller, So in other words, if you block too much, it shrinks, and so it just becomes less effective, and so that's why you kind of have to aim it, right?
Yeah, exactly.
It's kind of like blocking mid, high, or low.
Okay. Interesting.
Now, when your shield breaks, you go into the stun here, like this. When you're stunned, you can't shake out of that, right?
Yes, you can. You can. I'll show you.
Oh, okay.
Just can break you? My shield. Okay, that's fine. You simply have to mash all the buttons.
It still takes a... Okay,
You're still there forever.
In some games, for example, in Brawl, they qualify the barriers on some... You have to, like, for example, if you broke your shield at 100%, you'll have to do 300 inputs. So in Brawl, different buttons have different values. For example, A was two frames, B was 4, and then mashing the C stick was 25. So then you literally had to be like... So in this game, I'm actually not sure what makes you break out of hit stun. I mean, shield breaking easily, but... It literally, the guess of it is just mash your control as fast as you can.
Okay.
And then, talk about dodging and...
So while you're shielding, if you hit forward or back, you'll roll, but if you hit down, you'll do a spot dodge.
And if you hit up, you jump.
Yes.
Oh, if you have tap up.
Yeah, that's true. That is true. That is true.
I was like, wait, this is not doing anything for me.
And one thing to do note, for people that have tap jump off, you could just hit the jump button and then input the attack so that you'll be able to do things like... an immediate attack out of shield, like an up smash, a B, or even like short hop. You could short hop with the jump button and do a quick nair out of shield. So a lot of people, I notice when they're new to playing like Smash, if they block, the only option they usually go for is to roll, but you have other options too. You can, like we mentioned before, spot dodge. So in place, you'll kind of go into the background where you're invincible for a bit, and an attack would just phase through you, and then you could probably use your quickest attack if the move they used before that you spot dodge has a lot of cooldown. So a perfect example, even though this is like a really risky scenario, I'm just tossing this out there. Mm-hmm. Maybe you're blocking and a Bowser notices that you're shielding and he wants to down B you, right? If he tries to down B on top of you with the Bowser bomb, that can potentially break your shield. But then if you spot dodge it, then while he's in lag, you'll be able to counter attack. Right.
Well, you have to time it, which is the danger of the move.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Spot dodging is also great for grab battles. For example, some characters have powerful grab combos at 0%, so you want to dodge them by spot dodging. At the same time, in top level, people will bait out the spot dodges, so that creates a whole level plethora of tricks and different mental tricks that people can get on you.
So there's recovery on dodge.
There's lag.
So you're hittable for some period of time.
First, I will show you. When you spot this, let me see if I can pause. You see how Mario doesn't look transparent? This is the This is the very first frame he's vulnerable. But if I spot this right here, let me see. You see how he's kind of flash a little bit around?
Yeah, he's glowing.
He's vulnerable right here. He's invulnerable right here.
Okay.
But at the very end of the animation, he's... Not glowing.
Yeah. When he's going back. When he's going back.
In fact, some characters have weird animations. Like in Brawl, King Dedede, funny info. In Brawl, King Dedede's spot dodge, he will go back so much that when he was vulnerable, he will actually be unhittable because he was in the 3D spectrum of the game.
Yeah, which was off axis, basically.
Whoa!
Which made his spot dodge only punishable by 2 frames, where it was originally intended to be 20.
Oh, dang.
Which is the first
time... They just messed up.
Which is funny. Yeah. It doesn't happen in this game, but it's funny. It's funny.
So, okay. So, obviously, with rolls and spot dodges, you have a little bit of delay at the end of them, right? Can you throw them out of the spot dodges, or are you just completely invulnerable?
You're invulnerable. You have but the thing is that you have a window where you will be vulnerable. So, for example, do the spot dodge, for example. Uh-huh. Do it again. I can, for example, time an attack and they hit you, right?
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Which makes the move not entirely good.
Right.
But if I throw my move like this, try to spot dodge my grab if possible.
Oh, okay. I'll do just as fast as I can. Spot.
Oh, okay. Never mind. All right.
Okay.
But yeah, so basically what's being shown here to the viewers is... he's spot dodging and right near the recovery, when you're going back to a neutral state. You can't block as soon. I mean, it's even though spot dodges have, it's like the window for punishing is kind of difficult in comparison to maybe older ones, you can still punish them, you just have to get the timing.
Right.
Usually a move that's really active is probably the best decision.
Like dash attacks are really good to punish.
We call these lingering moves because, for example, if I throw my my upper, you know how upper doesn't really stay for that long?
Right.
But if I nair, like for example, stand up, you see how my nair can hit you even? You see that?
Yeah.
If you spot dodge and then I throw my nair,
right,
it's gonna literally hit you almost every time because
yeah,
it just stays out.
Okay.
So we use lingering moves for spot dodging, and then we use multi-hitting moves to hit shields because they wither them down more easily.
Which can potentially give you a shield stab, and what that entails is, like, if the shield's really small and you do a move that can potentially hit them as they're trying to shield because a part of their body was exposed, that is the shield stab.
Like right here.
Let me ask this question here. I noticed that when I play online a lot of the times, and I do this myself, like people saw me yesterday and were like, James rolls a lot.
Yeah.
So obviously online people roll like crazy like this, right? Like what is the best strategy for punishing people rolling all the time?
Try rolling against me.
Okay. Right.
Like one thing, like he just showed right there, down smashes, since they cover, most of them usually do cover both the front and the back. So if you're, if you corner someone, right, and you walk up to them and stand in a specific distance where if they roll behind you, they'll get hit by the down smash, you'll be able to punish
them. Gotcha.
Yeah. A universal punish too is just grabbing. A lot of players, I notice, they, you know, they'll go for like a running grab. Or even like if they know, if they walk up to the corner, like their opponent's in the corner, their back, their opponent's back's to the corner, you're walking them to the corner, then you realize they're initiating a roll, you can retreating dash into a pivot grab, so you can still control that space that and don't let them get out.
This is shown like this, for example.
For
example, try rolling from the edge. You'll see
that. So basically, if I like roll this way.
Like that. So you're still in control, stage control.
Are you grabbing the roll itself or the recovery of the roll?
The recovery.
Yeah.
Because when you roll, you're invincible during the half of it when you're moving. But then when you come back, you're vulnerable.
Okay. Yeah, and you could even see it too. Basically, whenever you're like flashing, like white, that shows that you're basically invincible. Kind of like with the even with
dodge.
And the air dodge too in midair.
So air dodge, if you're in the air, you just hit the shield button.
Or the grab button.
Yeah.
Or the grab button, yeah, okay. And then you're just invincible for that short amount of time, right? But on your way down, you can still do more stuff, correct? Like after the dodge is over, I can attack again.
Yeah,
right?
This is just like in the previous iteration of Smash Brothers. In Melee, if you air dodged in midair, you just go straight into that special free fall where you couldn't do anything and you were susceptible to attack. In this game, if just like Brawl, if you air dodge, you can definitely get punished when you're in the air, but the nice significant change that Sakurai made to this game when it comes to air dodges is that if you air dodge towards the ground, now you'll have landing lag.
Okay.
And it's a lot of landing lag. I believe it's around 10 to 20 frames, which is a big deal because in Brawl it was 2 frames.
Yeah, do it like right there. Yeah, try and like hold shield after you do it too, to see how fast it takes.
Interestingly enough, I know in Melee, you could air dodge in all 8 directions or in place if you wanted to, right? Is that not the case here in this
game?
No,
it's not the case, so because they prevented you from wave dashing. That's
right.
Because if you air dodge into the gun, you see how you slide?
Right.
If we were able to control distance, we will be able to air dodge and wave dash.
Okay. So they just made it now that whenever you air dodge, you just continue whatever jump momentum you had.
Yes.
Okay, cool. Yeah. So that's another defensive option right there, which is the air dodge. And it's pretty useful too, because I find myself like air dodging multiple times in the air and stuff like that, you know, just to get away.
Yeah, absolutely. The cool thing about that too is if you get knocked off stage, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, sometimes when you get knocked off stage, a top player will try to get in range to see if they can hit you out of your double jump as you're recovering. But the cool thing you can, that you can do is air dodge whatever offstage interception that they try to set up, and then using your double jump and up being back onto the stage safely.
Gotcha. Yeah, see, that's something I don't use. I never air dodge when I'm trying to get back on the stage, because I just feel like I'm going to air dodge and then fall to my death, right? So. Yeah, one thing we should probably also mention is that getting back on stage obviously is one of the most important things in this game. When you get knocked off, that's a whole game all unto itself, right?
Yes.
So,
so basically, like, the battle is not only on stage but off stage, which is what makes this game so exciting to me. The off stage edge guards.
It's my favorite part. Mm-hmm. Favorite part of the game. Yeah, yeah. Is when people chase you out here. But obviously, every stage you can grab these ledges here like that, right?
Yes.
And so, for the most part, everyone's up B. Whoops, I just killed myself here. everyone's up B is a, like, go up and try to catch the ledge kind of move, right? Most people's up Bs are an upwardish kind of move.
Yes.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
But for the most part, most everyone's up B, once you whiff it, it has that, it's punishable the entire way down, right? You have no action or recovery.
Like we said before, some moves have different variations of it based if it's on the ground or in the air. Mm-hmm. For example, Link's up being in the ground, he will spin around for a certain amount of time, making it a punish out of shield. But in the air, he will go all the way up.
Right, right. But see, like, on the way down, I'm vulnerable on Mario's.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Interesting enough, it's also dependent on character, too, because I noticed with Mega Man, when you bounce off of Rush, he can do anything he wants on the way down.
Just like Sonic.
Right?
Just like Sonic.
Yeah, Sonic and also Game & Watch, too.
That's
like,
so good.
You'll be able to basically, like, up B, and then, like, if somebody's trying to hit you, like James mentioned, you're free to use any attack except your up B again until you land.
Okay.
It sounds very good, but at the same time, their up Bs have no hitbox while going up, so you can easily go down there and just spike them to the wall.
Okay, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay. But yeah, so a lot of times, it's just kind of a battle of trying to get back over here onto the stage, right? Like, Mario, he can also use... Can he go up with his down A like he used to be able to
No, Dr. Mario can
just... Dr. Mario.
Dr. Mario's down B.
Okay.
They give Mario his flawed with a down B. Like,
right. This move here,
yes.
Yeah.
It seems very useless, but it was in Brawl. It was a really useless move. But in this game, they made a change that you can hit the ledge, like, below the ledge while people are grabbing it. So
I
now,
see.
Because there's less mechanics to when people try to grab the ledge, you can actually punish recovers with this move, making this move an actual dangerous move, because people can... For example, if I'm in my special free fall, and you hit me with that water, I will just instantly die.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's
an
instant
death.
Yes.
It just pushes you right
off
the stage.
For example, if
I'll
be like this, you know, I'm helpless. You know, if you shoot the water as I'm falling down, I can't grab it, then I die.
Okay.
Keep in
mind,
this is a move we made fun of in Brawl. Like, this is a move that everyone was like, why did they give Mario this?
Right,
he's useless.
Right. Okay, so this is also important to note that if you get hit in the air, you, like, for example, if I'm in free fall like this, if you hit me, I get actions again. Right, so if you hit me, I can up B again.
Yes,
I can't double jump again, but I can up B again.
Yes.
But the water isn't actually a hit.
Yeah.
It just pushes
it's
me,
a wind
right?
box. That's what we call it.
Wind box. Yeah,
okay.
There are a couple characters that have moves that basically, like, push you away, similar to Magneto's, I forgot
gravity.
What it was called, the gravity.
Yeah.
Okay, it's the
okay.
same thing, where it basically, like, it influences where you are on stage, but there's no damage being inflicted.
Right.
So it's pretty cool.
So that's why when you hit them with it, they can't action again because it's a wind box instead.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Do you want to talk about the mechanics of getting back on the ledge?
Yeah, the edges are definitely something we should talk about. It's different than all the other Smash games for sure. Because one thing to do note is when a person's occupying the edge, you can just trump them.
And then punish them because they have a period of time where they can not do anything.
Oh, really?
Yeah, look at this.
Oh, so basically you can bounce them off and then jump back and hit them?
In back air, yeah. Because you can let go, use your double jump to in conjunction with your back aerial, and boom, catch them while they're still in recovery from the ledge trump.
Holy crap.
Sweet.
Okay. I did not know that.
Yeah, I didn't either.
I thought they were invincible the whole time when they came off.
No. Let's do this. Let's try that again. I'll show you.
99 stock.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, we'll just do that. We were messing up. Oops. I picked normal one.
I thought I hit X. Did I hit it in time?
No, you did not.
Okay.
Oh, actually, we can still do it. It's fine.
We can still do it
on the stick. So try grabbing the ledge. And then, as soon as, when I throw you off the ledge, try doing anything.
Okay. Oh, yeah. I'm, like, really stuck on there for a little bit.
Huh.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Interesting. Okay.
And another thing, if you know someone's trying to get you with a ledge jump, you could just tap forward to get back on stage because you don't want to get yourself caught in that situation.
Right. Yeah. So when you're grabbing the ledge, you have a lot of options, which is actually really important in this game. So if you hit forward on the analog stick, you just climb up and you're invincible while you're flashing,
Yes, that's the best option so far. That everyone's been talking about when you're coming from the edge. Usually, a lot of people would tend to like drop from the edge, then use their double jump and immediately like do like an aerial while coming up from the edge.
Mm-hmm. But like, now, basically like this. Right?
Yeah, but now you lose all that invincibility in this game if you try to do that.
Okay.
So you have to be careful, which is why a lot of players just often go for the regular get up from the edge, and then they'll just mix them up.
And if you hit shield, you end up rolling forward like that.
Mm-hmm.
And you are invincible during that roll, right? But obviously, if just like regular roll, if the opponent predicts you, they can hit you at the end of that roll.
Precisely.
If you hit up, you actually jump off of it. Whoa, there's a platform. So if I hit up off the sledge, I get off with a jump.
Yep.
If I hit down, like you said, I just drop myself down. If I hit back, I just kind of fall off like that, right?
There's actually a big difference between pressing down and back, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Let me grab the ledge real quick, this one. If I press down, the game registers me as fast falling.
Yeah, you see the little spark.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But if I press back, it pulls me back from the ledge without fast falling, which allows me to.
Right.
Okay.
There's also another mechanic, which is Tekken, which... Wait.
Well, there's also one last one. If you hit an attack button, you actually get up with an attack, right? But that has those usually have a lot of lag at the end of them, right?
Not all of them. Some of them are almost lagless.
Really?
Some characters, some characters have really good get-up attacks. Like, for example, Fox's get-up attack, he has, like, a really weird disjointed hitbox that just, and then pushes back.
Cool.
Huh.
And he's
invulnerable
doing it. So, yeah, some characters have really good ones. Some characters have really bad ones.
Okay.
Yeah.
Some characters have longer rolls. When they roll from the ledge, they go, like, all the way out.
Right.
Mario's is, like, normal, you know? But look at the series, for example, like...
Show
you. By the way, did you see how that get up attack had
you see that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You see how she rolls really far away?
Yeah.
And look at her jump too, it's like.
Oh yeah, she goes really high off of that.
And she also has a flip.
Okay. So yeah, I mean, here's a question just for general purposes here.
Mm-hmm.
When you play, like, once you start getting at a high level of point of this game, how often do you say, what percentage would you say people are fighting off the stage?
Any. This is the cool part about Smash.
Mm-hmm.
In this game, because we don't really care about how much percent people have, we care about them dying.
Right.
So for example, I can potentially kill you at 0% from simply getting you off the stage.
Oh, I don't mean by damage percentage. Mm-hmm. What I mean is like in general,
like
when you guys are playing, like, would you say you spend half the game trying to kill someone off the ledge, or is it mostly in the middle of the stage, do as much damage, and then kill them?
I will say it's like 80-20.
80-20. Okay.
80 being on the stage?
80 on the stage, 20 off the stage.
Okay.
The thing is that the better the players are, the more dangerous it is to go off the stage, because, for example, against a high-level player, if I try to jump all the way out and they manage to turn around the situation and make it back to the stage, I'm off the stage and they're on the stage.
Yeah.
So I give them the chance to kill me at any percent. So,
Yeah, because I always remember, Evo East way back, long time ago, one of the first people that I saw that always went off the ledge to kill people was Mewtwo King.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, he's known for
he's
that.
He's definitely known for that. He's the master of the edge.
Yeah, well, and that was like when I saw him do that, I was just like blown away by like, because he would kill people and it looks like he would be dead too, and then he would make it back up
always.
And stuff like
that.
Always. We call him the ledge habitant. He lives on the ledge.
Ledge habitant, okay. Yeah, I mean, that's my favorite part of the game, is when you see people chase them. Like, when, what was it? Was it Silent Fox who did that?
Silent Wolf
who did that at Evo when he force-stalked, right?
No, Axe.
Oh, poor guy. We always mention this, but yeah.
That's right. Silent Wolf got force-stalked by Axe, right? Okay.
Oh, man.
So, for example, Fox in Melee is a really powerful character on the stage, and he also is good off the stage, but at the same time, if Fox gets hit one time off the stage, he usually instantly dies
90%.
Yeah.
So Pikachu is really good off the stage, so he...
Okay.
He got Silent Wolf essentially four times off the session. Just
right.
Easy.
Okay, cool.
But the thing is that in every Smash game, they have toned down edge guarding.
Oh,
For example, in Melee, they have different ledge mechanics where people will not be able to grab the ledge with the recoveries. Like, for example, if you up onto your into the ledge, do you see how the game didn't really let, that's perfect, actually. Do you see how the game didn't really let you grab it?
Right.
But if you did that, the exact same one in Brawl, you will actually grab it.
Oh, really?
Yes, and in Melee, so for example, if you try to grab it with the up right now.
Like if I went like this?
Yes. You see how I didn't hit you?
Yeah.
In the exact same scenario in Melee, people don't auto-grab the ledge when they're really close to it. So I can hit them with this down smash and then kill them off of it. That's what happens in Melee. In Brawl, the magnetism where people grab the ledge, because if you approach the ledge, you see how you grab it not really
next
to it, but like around it? In Brawl, it's like 40% more. That magnetism. In Melee, there's no magnetism at all. And in this game, there's like a little bit more magnetism than in Melee.
Kind of in between.
Which is a big difference, because it means that ledge gameplay is a lot more present in the game, but not as much.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. Huh. Dang, it's like all these little subtle differences between the game. Yeah. I mean, it's easy for, we're like, oh, between Super Turbo and Third Strike, it's just like...
Yeah, exactly. I don't know much about Street Fighter, so there you go.
Yeah, exactly. So that's actually really fascinating to know that it's like different like that. That's really cool.
In fact, there's really almost no tournament players that play more than one game in tournament. Like, if you think about Melee top players, other than Mewtwo King, because he's known for playing all the Smash games, the other ones don't really play all the Smash games in tournament. Same for the Brawl players, and same for the other Smash players. So, the amount of, like, top players that can do the Justin Wong, which is, like, play all the different fighting games together, is, like, maybe, like, Jason, myself, and then...
Mm-hmm. Why is that? Just out of curiosity.
It's really hard because, like, in Melee, you have, like, Wave Dash and L Cancel and all these advanced techniques of movement, and then you play another game, and you're like, okay, this is changed on all this different frame data, this ledge is different, jumping is different, my character is different, played three different characters, 50 different matchups, it's difficult.
The mechanics are completely different. Like you said, in Melee, you have so much control over movement, compared in comparison to this game, where there's a lot of things that are kind of limited, especially when it comes to like dashing, and you know how it's easy for people to come back, since like you said, the magnetism, that auto ledge snap, people are able to easily just come back and snap perfectly on the edge and not have to worry about maybe going a little bit above the edge, because in this space there'll be and in Melee, like, you'd get hit, but in this game you definitely are able to recover easier.
Okay. You're able to recover easier, but at the same time, you get hit way more than in Brawl, which is an important change.
Okay.
And also adding on to that, the big differences are that it's kind of like how you can play, I don't know, someone that's really good in Street Fighter 2 will be able to play at a decent level Street Fighter 4, but at the same time, he won't know any of the intrinsics that he has to do in Street Fighter 4 to abuse the game in a way to win, right? That's why playing multiple Smash games is difficult here, because, you know, I might be able to play Smash 4 really well, and I might be able to play Melee at a fundamental level decently enough, but that doesn't mean I can master the game engines completely, which is the big difference.
I mean, it's kind of interesting, because, like, guys like Vi and Watson and Choi and those guys, they would be able to go from, like, Alpha 2 and Alpha 3 and switch between them, and they have, like, wildly different mechanics, but they're actually the same graphics. Like, I don't know how they did that, to be honest, because I can't do that. Like, every time I try to switch between those games, it messes me up really badly. I mean, I'll go from, like, Street Fighter 4 to Super Turbo.
Yeah.
And those games look completely different, and I'll try to throw with jab and short in Super Turbo, you know what I mean? So it's crazy.
I'm sorry, not to cut you off, but I just remembered there was another thing we didn't touch on. In Brawl, one thing that was really, like, bad in the game was planking, right? And what that necessarily is...
What's
if,
planking?
Well, if you're...
Planking is... I'll show you. You know how when you grab the ledge, you're invincible? Okay. In Brawl, whenever you grab the ledge, and you let it go, and then you grab it again, you will regain the same amount of invincibility frames. This is important because people were able to do this. Like, imagine I'm invincible while doing this.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
So people were able to stall in the ledge invincibly completely.
This was very popular
because of a character called Meta Knight and also other ones in Brawl that were able to grab the ledge and use quick moves that will hit through the stage, making it impossible for people to get them off the stage, which led to a very campy metagame to develop later on when people really try to win.
So they could actually drop off, like, attack and catch the ledge again and stay invincible the whole entire time, basically.
Yeah. And what made it even worse was that since in Brawl, people were able to, like, snap the edge easily, you know, like ledge snap perfectly when they use their B, you weren't really at a disadvantage for doing this a lot. Like, it's like, okay, let me just up B perfectly, grab the edge, and just keep doing this over and over. But now with this game, if you were to, you know, just basically short hop, no, ledge hop a move at the edge, and then let go and try to re-grab, you could see right there, you're not flashing.
Yeah. I have no invincibility.
Yeah.
In this game, once you let go of the ledge, the game doesn't allow you to have invincibility frames again.
Okay.
Until three things happen. Uh-huh. You get hit, enough airtime goes by, or you grab the ledge with a special move, like, for example, like
Better or something. Link or something like
and,
that.
And this is entirely an anti-planting mechanic, and also the other big one is that when someone grabs the ledge, like, can you grab the ledge real quick?
Sure.
You see how I throw you off the ledge when I grab it?
Like, you see.
Like, right here, I just knock you
off.
This is so, for example, if someone were to find a way somehow to plant, I can still take the ledge from you. I can stop it from doing it. It's like, stop it.
Right. Okay. And like you said, you can hit him afterwards, right?
For example, if you let go down right now and you go back up the ledge, I can just hit you.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah, so moves that basically like hit at your feet or whoever's at the edge, you'll basically get them for trying to let go and re-grab again, which kind of promotes more of an aggressive play style.
Yeah.
Like, people can now just, if they notice they're at the edge and their opponent's standing there, they're going to have to think quick. You can't just let go and re-grab.
And if you see them hitting on the ledge and you grab them and pop them off, you can actually punish them. So that's really cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
You do have to be careful though, because if you go for that and your opponent knows, they can just do a normal get up, and now you're the one on the edge. and they're on stage.
Right.
So
yeah.
There's actually another really big change that's only in this game. Like, for example, can you jump all the way out?
Oh, all the way out of the screen.
And then make it back without B? You know how in other games, if I did the exact same thing, you will just fall down to your death, like in Melee or Brawl?
Right, because you're invincible when you grab the ledge,
and then people don't knock me off the ledge. In this game, you can no longer ledge hog people, which is a very big thing.
Mm-hmm. Right,
in this
game,
there's a lot of ledge play. Like, for example, okay, you're in the ledge, you're in a bad position, what do I do? What is he going to do? For example, try getting off the ledge for me.
Okay. Right.
Now you have no invincibility frame, so I can hit you, and then you're here. And then I just space this. It's like there's a lot of different mechanics in this game. There's a lot of ledge play.
Right.
There's more ledge garden. So it's
because I always remembered in Melee that was just a big strategy. You knock them off and then just grab the ledge right when they're up,
and then they die.
Then they die anyway.
Oh, and another thing to also note, if you're blocking at the edge with your back to the edge and then your opponent does like a smash attack to push you off, usually it pushes the person off and it forces them to grab edge. In this game, you're stuck right there at the edge, so it's kind of risky. Okay, watch. Basically, both of you guys have to be on stage, but one person has to have their back to the edge like that, like zero suit, and blocking, and just do a smash attack. Yeah, well, see, he's not getting pushed off.
I see, right.
Smash games, you will just fall off.
Oh, so you can't push someone off with attacks anymore.
Okay.
But you know what's important about this change is that it may seem bad at first, you know, promoting people to shield, but at the same time, as you can see, shielding is much weaker than it was in any other Smash game.
Oh, okay.
Like, you saw one single smash attack from Mario, it almost broke my shield in one swing. So in this game, okay, sure, you can shield. The game tells you, sure, shielding is a good option, but only for so long.
Right.
Exactly.
They made shielding a lot more less endurable.
Yes.
Right? Less
promoting more aggressive play, especially with the ledge changes and the shield changes. Smash 4 is a much more aggressive game than Brawl.
Mm-hmm.
So when Sakurai said that it was a mix of Brawl and Melee, he was actually very right.
Okay,
cool.
Nice, I like that. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it really feels like he did a lot of work, like, thinking about how to make it, like, more fair and just, like, balanced mechanic-wise then, okay, cool.
The thing is that Sakurai does not want to make the game completely competitive because he doesn't want to make people uncomfortable that don't play competitively but can sometimes play into competitive people. Because you can see there's a spectrum. You know how there's creeping in Brawl? People can just randomly trip.
Yeah.
The reason Sakurai did that is because he assumed that people with better people will have more control of their characters, so he wanted to give less skilled players the option to at least punish them sometimes because the game allow you to do so.
By principle,
that is not bad. By principle, obviously, it was not implemented in the best of ways. So what they did in this game, for example, mechanics like the ledge one, where I can throw you off, those are more casual oriented mechanics, allowing people to have an easier time while recovering.
But at the same time,
top level players will still kill you if you grab the ledge because they can cover your options.
Right,
but at the same time,
right.
it's a toss up of making the option more casual for less experienced players, but at the same time giving the depth enough for top level players to abuse you if you make bad decisions.
So in other words, they did it smartly instead of, because obviously tripping is like one of the most universally loathed
universally hated mechanics.
And
when listen, the day we learned there was no tripping, I was like,
Praise.
Yeah. I can
say that.
No one liked it. No one liked
it. That was the worst.
We don't say that, though. We don't say that like that.
Okay. Well, I mean, is there any other mechanics that we want to talk about?
Foot stooling, for sure.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Stand here. Whoop.
Whoop. Does that come into play practically?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, jump off the stage.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's kind of hard.
It's actually a meteor smash, right? If you footstool them.
There's a defense. There's three. Okay, let me. Wait. I'll show you. Well, first off, there's two different levels of downward movement. I mean, attacks. I'm sorry.
Uh-huh.
Meteor smashes are the one you can actually cancel, like in Melee and Brawl. You're able to cancel the downward momentum with a jump after a few frames.
Uh-huh.
And it'll be the more percent you have, the more frames you will be stunned until you can cancel.
Right.
And the game will punish you because if you were late on your cancel, the game will not allow you to cancel anymore. So you just die.
So you have a small window.
A small window, yes.
Okay.
In this game, every single attack is a spike.
Yeah.
You cannot cancel. You just die. That's it.
Right,
no more.
Right.
Yeah, basically.
So there's no meteor smash in this game?
No, there's none.
Wow.
The only way you can come back from a spike is if the hitstun wears off. That's it.
Because it means low percents. But
so
in this game,
if you're like high enough and they spike you up there, you can recover, right? Okay.
Sometimes, depends. Some spikes are really powerful, like Captain Falcon's. But Mario's spike is not really that powerful.
Oh, right.
But it does more damage.
Okay. But so the footstool jump,
there we go.
There it is.
Right.
You die.
Yeah.
The footstool is very powerful for characters like Zero. You see, look at how far I can go off the stage. I can footstool you around here. And then I can barely recover.
Right, you can still make it back, right?
Yeah,
right.
Like,
gotcha. Ooh. Okay. Yeah.
I can actually recover from that.
Okay, gotcha. But what about in the middle of the stage? Is there really any advantage of it?
Yeah. For example, shield. I can foot through your shield.
Oh,
that's
okay.
A cross-up. For example,
that.
If you're shielding, and then I can just jump above you, and I'm like, nope, I'm not landing in front of you. I'm landing away from you.
Oh,
that's really huge in top-level gameplay. Like, I can't tell you how many times I've been in a bad position. I'm just like, oh, jump above your smash attack. Because you can footstool people while they're doing a smash attack. Like, do a force smash. You see that?
What?
So, for example, I can completely cross you up. So
and it cancels my attack when you footstool me
as
well, right? Okay.
Yeah, some characters, for example, can footstool you and then punish you right away.
Right,
like
okay.
Because they have like a downward momentum like this.
Interesting.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. So footstooling adds the third option because you know how people, when you're like expecting someone to land, they can either land with an arrow, so you expect the attack option in your mind. That's one option. And then you expect them to dodge, right?
Uh-huh.
Like this, right? So that's two options. In your mind, you're like, I just need to wait. But what if you're waiting like this? Like, oh, I'm just going to wait for them to land and just, boop, nope, I'm out.
Okay.
The third option
okay.
that's always in the back of your head. Very few people have actually mastered this option because it's dangerous. Some people, for example, will wait for you to be close. For example, let's say I'm around this area. So around this distance, they're going to be like, okay, in this distance, he can either do an air dodge or drop down with an arrow or footstool me.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So some people, this is what we call frame traps. Let me unpause. So for example, if my opponent can air dodge or fall down with an attack, I will quickly do an upper like this, right?
Uh-huh, okay.
And if they air dodge through, which is the only option that they won't get hit by, even if they try to footstool me, I can do another one on landing, which covers them completely.
Right.
So if they fall down with me, they're frame trap because it doesn't matter what option they do, they get hit.
Mm.
Okay,
at high level Brawl and Smash 4, the best way to play is for frame trapping because you don't have enough combos to finish off a stock. For example, with Fox, which is the character that I main in this game, you can dash attack someone. They go up in the air. They can either attack, jump, or air dodge. You shield, then you spot dodge because even if they hit or air dodge, you can still have the frame data to up tilt them back.
Mm,
you combo them
a
few times, and then you either wait for them to jump, and then you can jump back. You spike them down to the ground. You wait. They can either spot dodge or attack, and then you just keep on going, and you can keep frame trapping them by using correct amount of attack. So in this game, while you may not have melee SK combos where you can just grab someone and just, ooh, they die, explode in the air, in this game, you actually have to use your head and understand of the mechanics of the game and characters to combo them to death. Because in Brawl, you didn't have the options to directly kill people, but in this game you can actually frame trap people from 0% to death.
Right,
if you're
right.
good enough.
So, so I mean, okay. Melee obviously very combo heavy game.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right. This is much less combo heavy, right?
If let's say Melee was 100% combo oriented, Bro was like 20% combo oriented. This game is like 60-70% combo.
Oh, okay. So it's actually more than Brawl. Then.
Way more.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Way more.
Okay.
Way more.
Okay. But still, compared to Melee, there
it's
is
less.
Still more neutral game and
yeah.
stuff
it's,
like
it,
that, right?
Like Sakurai said, it's a good mix between Brawl and Melee. You have combos that are very Melee-esque. Like, for example, Falcon can do upper to knee, which is a Melee combo that will never work in Brawl. Never! But in this game, you can actually upper someone 6 times in a row.
Okay, okay. Gotcha. Oh, nice.
Okay.
Yeah, I even remember seeing some of the trailers that they put out. They were even showing combos,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah,
yeah,
with
so.
Sonic and such.
Yeah.
That's
okay.
when people got really excited.
Mm-hmm. is there anything else you wanted to cover mechanics-wise? Because what I think we could do is probably take a short break because we have food.
Yep.
So we want to eat, and then we'll come back. So guys, you this is your chance to like you know use the bathroom or go eat yourself. And what we'll do is we'll take a short break. We'll eat a little bit, and then we'll come back and then do the characters. But
yeah.
I don't know how many characters we can cover today.
I mean, yeah,
there's
lots of
players. What if we do
deep.
A challenge? What if we do a challenge? How much can we explain of each character in 2 minutes?
It's up to you guys, because you're going to be the ones
how,
doing it.
Well,
so.
I mean, I'm down. I'm,
yeah,
I'm,
we'll
I'm,
just
I'm,
have
well,
to be quick.
What we can do, honestly, like, what we can do is just look at the character select screen and just describe each of the characters in a very summary form,
okay.
and, then go into details with maybe, like, 10 characters or something like that.
The top tier ones.
Yeah, because I just want to know, like, who's a defensive character? Is this a speed character? Is this like what they're generally? I mean,
so,
is that are you okay with that? Or?
I kind of like the 2 minute idea.
Okay,
yeah.
Let's try
it sounds
to
like
two.
A challenge.
Okay, okay,
like,
okay,
we go quickly. All right, guys. So Mario. Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
All right, Luigi. Blah, 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 blah. All right, guys.
Sounds good.
Okay,
yeah,
okay. Let's try it. Okay,
right.
We'll be back in about like 20 minutes or so, like that. We'll get some food. 15 minutes, you think?
I don't know. We can just eat while we're doing this. Like, who cares?
Okay, sure.
So we'll be back in a few.
We'll be back. Okay.